Karlsson, Karlsson, världens bästa Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, hoj här kommer Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, ingen faktiskt, ingen annan Karlsson vill jag så bra som mig.
Karlsson, Karlsson, Karlsson scores!
The Kings are beating the Blackhawks 2-0. It's 3-1 for Winnipeg over Philly, and Arizona is up 1-0 over Vegas, and we are back for part two of the Keeping Karlsson Mega Show, the third period. Here we go, Brian. What's going on? How are you since we just recorded? You hate when I ask you how are you. I won't even ask that, but I will just say that I had a blast talking about all the injuries and outries with you, but we've got a ton to talk about in part two. And do you have any final thoughts on any of that stuff from the past before we dive into... I'll tell you where we're going to start. We're going to start in Boston. We're going to talk about how we were not wrong, but just like, you know, we gave advice last week and they changed up all the lines and made our advice useless. So we'll see how that goes today. But are you ready to jump into that or what's going on?
Yeah, I think we have one loop to close. By the way, I don't hate when you ask me how I am. I love it. I just don't know that it's good content, you know, that anyone really... Okay.
Maybe they care. They're listening to... How many episodes? This is episode 471. That people might care. Like, who is this guy? How's he doing?
Well, then become a patron and listen to the patron cast. I'll tell you way too much about how I'm doing. Yeah, one thing to close the loop on from periods one and two, Elon, because this is the start of the third period of our show, is that the award that goes to the top AHL goaltender is called the Baz Bastion Award.
Okay.
The Aldij, I don't know how to pronounce his name. I guess Baz was a nickname. It's a memorial award presented to the AHL's best goaltender. It was originally called the Harry Hap Holmes Memorial Award. And then I guess Baz Bastion was a general manager of a team. And then he died prematurely in a car crash, and they named this award after him. So sorry to Harry Hap Holmes, and of course Baz Bastion and his family. Anyway, do you know the only two? You'll never name them. The two-time winners of the Baz Bastion Award.
Oh, two-time winners. Okay. Well, no, I don't.
You'll never guess them. It's impossible. Okay, so we've got Mark LaForest, who was terrible for the Ottawa Senators in NHL 94 and 95. And then you had like the video game. I mean, and the other two-time winner was Jason LaBarbera. Recent winners. It's an interesting list, actually, Elon. You've got the most recent winner, Dustin Wolf in the Flames system. Yeah,
people say he's going to be so good.
Logan Thompson.
Very good.
Kaapo Kähkönen.
High pedigree. I don't know.
Alex Nedeljkovic, Garrett Sparks, Troy Grosnick, Peter Budaj.
He had that one good year.
But like a lot of these guys are winning it in the front end of their careers. And I think Peter Budaj was like semi-retired when he won. Matt Murray, Jake Allen,
Matt Murray,
Nicholas Svedberg, Jan Danis, Brad Thiessen, Jonathan Bernier, Corey Schneider, Michael Layton.
Are you going to do the whole list?
I just went back to Jason LaBarbera's second win.
Oh, okay. I like how before we actually pressed record, you were like, let's knock this out. And then you read like 20 winners of the Baz Bastion Award. I'm excited to see that Felix Potvin. He was my favorite goalie growing up. He won it before his first season. That's cool. But okay.
Wow.
Look at that, Brian. So here we are ready to die.
The year after Mark LaForest won his second.
There you go. I hope that people enjoyed my new intro I tried out instead of this subdued voice. I don't want to be subdued. I want to get excited about what's going on in fantasy hockey here, okay? And we're going to talk about the Boston Bruins now. I'm going to do a segment on line shakeups, okay? Just teams that have been doing lines that are not familiar to us from recent play. And in Boston, they've gone back to the Pasta, Krejci, Zacha, all check second line or first line, whatever you want to call it. And you know, so before, I think the last time we talked about Boston, they were going with Pasternak, Marchand, and Bergeron, which made kind of like everyone else not too valuable. Since then, if Pasta's back with Krejci and Zacha, amazing news for Krejci and Zacha, because David Pasternak is insane. Before today's game, Pasternak has been on a run of 13 points in his last 8 games. I'm seeing he has an assist today. It's like a 1 assist game for Pasternak is actually disappointing. We're only halfway through, so I'm sure he'll score another couple goals to really keep this streak going. And so yeah, great news for David Krejci, 6 assists in his last 3 games going into today. And then also Pavel Zacha, a guy who was available in free agency in like all leagues, had a huge week, a 3-game point streak, 5 points. It started with a 3-point game. So I think at this point, going into next week, Boston plays 4 games. If you're interested in someone from that team, obviously we talked about on the matchup maximizer how you may not have room for all of those games, but if you do have room, all of a sudden you've got some potentially interesting free agents, a Pavel Zacha or a Craig Smith, who's on the top line right now with Bergeron and Marchand. And Craig Smith, I believe, yeah, he has an assist today on a Hampus Lindholm goal. So there's points to be had over in Boston just by like looking at who Marchand, Bergeron, and or Pasternak are playing with, because those three are insane. I actually wanted to just point out with Brad Marchand before I throw to you. So Brad Marchand missed training camp, right? Isn't that a thing we sometimes say, how a player is going to miss training camp so they might not be like at 100% right away, might struggle? Like, this guy's so good. He has 43 points in 37 games now since coming back from his injury. I looked at his career stats. I wonder how many people would guess that Marchand is below a point per game in his career. He has 838 points in 911 career games. Like, feels like he's been a like 90 plus 100 point guy like forever, like since we started doing the podcast. But he had this whole career beforehand where he was so far below a point per game that even with this amazing stretch of like a decade almost, he's still not even there, and he's probably not going to get there. Maybe he will, I don't know. But yeah, what a weird career for Brad Marchand. But anyways, any interest in Krejci? Well, obviously you have interest, right, in Krejci, but like Zacha or Craig Smith, are we going to recommend people grab them while they're on these lines?
So Pavel, yeah, I mean, I'm interested in all these guys. This is great deployment for everybody when Boston splits their top two lines and Pasternak on the second is helping others produce. We can see Boston run a full, basically completely rosterable top six, and maybe the sixth piece is a streamer. But we're very interested in what's happening in Boston. Pavel Zacha, 3 goals on his last 6 shots going into tonight. So, you know, that's not something you can put your name on, that it's going to work out all the way for sure. But nice little post-new contract bump that Zacha's on in this run. David Krejci, great apples. He's going to apple picking. Great run with Pasternak earlier this year, too. Lots of assists to Pasternak's goals. Great place for Krejci to be. And then Craig Smith, nice to see him put up points. The guy also refuses, like outright refuses to shoot. He has, going into tonight, 2 shots in his last 5 games so far tonight in 4.5 minutes of play. Craig Smith has an assist, but he has more assists than shots, which is none. Elon, I want to bring up one other thing here that you know, you talked about Marchand, and it's amazing. I actually remember, we could probably find the Keeping Carlson episode where Marchand, or the episode where Marchand was emerging as being like a power play threat. And I'm going to cop to being initially skeptical. Like, I was like, Brad Marchand has never played in this role before. He's like a middle six checking winger. And that seems to be as much as he's ever been used in that kind of role. And we were just like, I remember being really surprised when he stepped up and kept doing what he was doing. It'd be fun to go back and see if we find those.
Yeah.
Well, the tape from that. It's
maybe
out
now
there.
The question is, like, who's the current? Who's the player who's played like 500 games in the NHL and is about to just go off and become a superstar?
Yeah, Boone Jenner.
Well, oh, maybe. Well, I remember last year, actually, I was thinking like maybe JT Miller was stepping into that role.
Yeah.
As controversial as it's been, like, JT Miller still keeps on producing, so maybe he's the next one.
Yeah, but actually, I'm going to move from Brad Marchand and focus just for a minute on David Pasternak, and not in the same favorable way that you were stopping to chat about Brad Marchand. I know.
How dare
you? I know. David Pasternak, no shots in his last game. If we're going to harp on Craig Smith for not shooting, it's only fair. I do the same for Pasternak. But why this stands out, that's the only game this season that Pasternak hasn't produced a shot on goal. Twice, he's produced a single shot on goal. Every other game, at least 2, often more, including 6, 7, 8 shot games. And then going back for the 3 games before the 0-shot game, only 9 shots for Pasternak, which is, yeah, still 3 shots a game. That's good. But this is a guy who's averaged 5 shots per night. And I'm seeing a couple games where Pasta played fewer than 15 minutes in the last couple weeks. So one of those was a night where he scored a hat trick, got an assist, and took 8 shots. So I'm not going to read too much into that. But this is just me saying, keep an eye out, I guess, on what's going on with Pasternak and why he's not shooting and why he's playing a little less so far. And 7 minutes of ice time tonight. No shots for Pasternak, but an assist. But that's not what we want. We want Pasternak firing away. Patty in the chat, I saw her tweet just as we were starting to talk about this, and I asked her, like, hey, tell me more. She was mad that Pasternak is passing to Taylor Hall on the power play. Like, Hall is the shooter on the power play, and yeah, I agree. Like, what's up with that? I don't know. This is a change in scenario. So I don't know, Elon. I don't think there's anything to do. I'm not about to overreact and say, if you have Pasternak, sell in case he's injured. I'm not saying that. But I am going to keep an eye on things over the next few games. I want to make sure that Pasta is playing as many minutes as he normally does and shooting about as often as he usually does and not suddenly deferring a whole bunch because, well, Krejci and Zaka aren't any better shooters than Pasternak. No one on Boston, including on that top power play unit, is a better shooter than David Pasternak. So I would hope that he is the one pulling the trigger unless something's wrong, which I'm not saying there is. I'm just saying my antennae are up.
Yeah, I mean, I would need to see a longer stretch. Like, it was like, what, like a 3 games or something?
It's just so rare. It's a testament to how used to seeing Pasta shoot. Yeah. Like, we all are. It's such a fixture that even 3 shots a game for 3 games is like, oh, I don't know about this, Elon.
I don't know. Okay. So that's your opinion. Okay.
There's nothing to do about it. I'm not. That's your opinion is a classic line for when, like, you just want to move on.
Saying, like,
you're embarrassed by what someone else has said. Okay. That's your opinion. Next player.
I don't know. I could respond, but I also don't want to spend more time talking about this, like, nothing burger. So let's just go to Colorado next, who has shaken things up. They've split up MacKinnon and Rantanen, which is, like, not something they've done very much. I guess they've done it, like, periodically throughout the time that we've been doing this podcast. Usually we'd be like concerned, you know, like, oh, is this bad news for Rantanen? Or I remember Landeskog would be off that line, like, oh, is this bad news for Landeskog? But like at this point, like, we just know that, like, both of these guys are such superstars, it doesn't matter, right? Like, MacKinnon and Rantanen both having like incredible seasons. I don't even think it's like with Draisaitl and MacKinnon, right? Like, I could spend time talking about how amazing these two are doing, but everyone already knows. So maybe we could just move on to like all these other guys, because the nice thing about having MacKinnon and Rantanen and split is it all of a sudden makes a lot of players on Colorado become interesting, because that means now we have 4 players that potentially can be exposed to MacKinnon and Rantanen at even strength. So in the last game, unfortunately, they're not going to make it easy for us because they kind of switched up the lines a little bit, but they started with Rodriguez and Lehkonen playing with MacKinnon, but then at some point Nichushkin, who was playing with Rantanen, he moved up to play with MacKinnon and Lehkonen. And then Evan Rodriguez actually ended up going like to the a line with like Cogliano and Logan O'Connor. So I don't know if like Rodriguez like did something to piss someone off, or if they just wanted to shake things up. So then Rantanen was playing with JT Compher and Alex Newhook for a bit, with Newhook taking over for Nichushkin, who moved to the top line. So don't worry, there's not going to be a test. You don't need to memorize all of this. I'll just say that obviously you got to check the lines before the next game. But in the meantime, like, Lehkonen, we already know, is really good. And like, Brian and I made a huge mistake both dropping him a million years ago at this point. He's got 7 points in his last 5 games. He's like a fixture on the top line and top power play. I don't think Landeskog's coming back anytime soon to bump him. Valeri Nichushkin was actually cold for a little bit, but with MacKinnon and Rantanen going off, he's actually not going off like crazy, but he does have like 6 shots in his last game versus Seattle, even though he didn't get a point. But I'm assuming, Brian, we're still into Nichushkin. And I guess the one that jumps out to me right now is like JT Compher is someone who I thought would like be valuable like during that time when MacKinnon was hurt and he was getting like some better deployment, different people were hurt. But like Compher like continues to produce. He's now up to 5 points in his last 4 games. He's been playing with Rantanen. So I think at this point, if he's available in free agency in your league, you got to start thinking if maybe it's time to jump on the JT Compher train.
Yeah, another guy who doesn't shoot, but if he's available in your league and that's not going to bother you too much, he is a forward who blocks, if that helps you, and occasionally hits as well. So JT Compher has some value if you don't mind. No shots on goal. It's a couple power play points from the second unit, which is one of the reasons why JT Compher is as hot as he is right now. We don't expect that to continue. However, Elon, at any moment, if you were like, do you want the guy playing with Mikko Rantanen? I would say yes, absolutely. And I wouldn't even take a moment to ask, well, is Nathan MacKinnon there too? Doesn't need to be. Are you playing with Mikko Rantanen for JT Compher? The answer has been yes. So yeah, I'm interested in everybody exposed to MacKinnon and Rantanen, which includes Lehkonen, of course, Nichushkin, of course, and Evan Rodriguez and JT Compher.
Yeah, I didn't even notice these blocks, but yeah, he is among the top of the league. Looks like he's around like top 10 in forwards for blocks. You know who else blocks a lot of shots? Some like superstars that we'd never give them credit for. But Austin Matthews has 55 blocks this year in 45 games. Elias Pettersson has 50 blocks.
Are you looking at like the top of the table? Like, where do these guys rank amongst forwards in the whole NHL?
Okay, I got to give you the full list here. According to Frozen Tools, Josh Brown is number 1. He's on the Coyotes. He has 68 blocks. Then Nick Bonino. then Kopitar, another superstar, like then Matthews, Garnett Hathaway, Elias Pettersson, then Christian Dvorak, Phil Deneau, and then you go a little bit further and you get to JT Compher. So yeah, extra value to these guys, underrated. Definitely. A forward that blocks. We never talk about it. We probably should. So thanks for bringing that up. But okay, let's go to some other interesting lines. Okay, in Detroit, Detroit's just doing crazy stuff. They're like really keeping us on our toes because they had that stretch where Dominik Kubalík was on a top line and he was like producing and doing so well. And then out of nowhere, he just got like sent to the third line and second power play. And then it was like everyone was dropping Kubalík. And then we were talking about Michael Rasmussen for a bit, who was getting in a good spot. Then, you know, he got sent and now no one cares about him anymore. And now all of a sudden, Dominik Kubalík is back. In his good spot. In the last game, Kubalík was playing with Larkin and Lucas Raymond. Of course, Tyler Bertuzzi is injured, and maybe he'll come back and he'll all get shaken up again. But I think if you were excited about Kubalík back before when he was hot, like now he's got points in two straight games. He's playing on this top line. I don't know. Maybe you're not like as excited as last time, because maybe last time it was like, oh, maybe like he's like now entrenched. Like maybe like, you know, he's getting an opportunity he didn't get before and now the coach has unlocked something. But the fact that he was so easily like sent down the lineup means that maybe it's going to happen again. But in the meantime, he went on a really great run earlier in the year and I felt really dumb for not having added him. So I actually have the opportunity to add him in a couple if he doesn't, you know, I'm out of moves for this week. We'll see if he's still available at 3 a.m. But I maybe have to jump on him, even if I don't have room for him. But maybe you'll tell me that I don't need to.
That was my question. If you don't have room for Kubalík, are you going to still jump on him? And maybe I'll share my piece and then you can answer that question. My piece is actually really short. And you've basically summed it up. We know that Kubalík, when he gets hot. And you always feel badly if you're not the one who jumped on him. And maybe it's a waste of a move. Maybe this is just a flash in the pan. Like, hot Elon is debatable right now because Kubalík has points in consecutive games, but that's it, right? It's nice that Kubalík, if I want to look for more, he's taken at least two shots in consecutive games as well, which he hasn't done so often over the last little while. So two reasons to think that maybe Kubalík is about to start a run, but you're right. Usually you need to be on the front end of that to enjoy what's to come. So I'll rephrase the question for you, Elon. You have no room. Kubalík gets zero games for you next week. Are you making a move to add him?
I mean, probably not. Because like I said, I need to win out, right? Like, my team is not in a position to take it easy. But maybe if I'm high up in the standings and I could afford to cruise a little bit, maybe it is worth taking a shot just in case. But I would love if Tyler Bertuzzi could come back and we can get the updated lines with Bertuzzi back just to see. And again, like, even that, like, they could change again so quickly. So I guess my answer is no. If you have room, I would stream him in because he can get hot, but it's far from a sure thing, right? So maybe you have better options out there.
That's where I'm at too. I think it's still too soon to like rationally jump on. If you want to like really do a big speculative ad, you can go and get him. But at this point, I don't think we've seen enough to know that Kubalík has entered hot mode territory.
There's nobody in hot mode territory on the New York Islanders, unfortunately, which is where I want to go next. This team is doing anything they can to try to get some goals. And yeah, it's not working. So the latest line. So we've got Anders Lee and Matt Barzal reunited. It feels like it's been forever, right? Like, Lee and Nelson were together for so long and doing so well. Like, midway through last year, they made that switch and it seemed to work out really well for all parties involved. But yeah, the Islanders just trying to get something going. And all of a sudden, like, it didn't help. Right, in this last game versus Carolina, the Islanders lost 5-2. Anders Lee did have an assist, his first point in six games. Matt Barzal, no points, and he is now pointless in seven games. Barzal just like, and I know the short shifts guys talked about it, but like I need to talk about it with you also, Brian. Like, it's just like, this stinks. I traded Trevor Zegras for Matt Barzal, and you told me that you thought it was a good move. And then afterwards, Barzal went on this great hot run. And I was like, that was a good move. All right. I messaged you privately. I was like, Brian, I just want to tell you, that was a really good suggestion you gave. Now, this is fantasy hockey, right? Now, all of a sudden, Barzal, pointless in seven. Trevor Zegras, hottest player in the league. 9 points in his last five games. Just destroying. So anyways, we'll get to Anaheim in just a sec. What are we doing on the Islanders here? Like, are they ever going to score again more than like one or two goals a game? Like, or are Barzal, and then to a lesser extent, like maybe obviously you say you got to hold Barzal. Like, what are you doing? But like, Anders Lee, you know, I don't know. By the way, Ryan Pulock, another change they've done to try to like shake things up. Ryan Pulock was on the top power play the last game. They went three forwards and two defensemen. Didn't help. I'm sure it'll, you know, I'm not going to recommend you get Ryan Pulock. He's done nothing all season. Yeah, curious to know, like, how nervous are you about the Islanders right now?
pretty nervous, but not so nervous. Like, this is a bad run of luck for the whole team. The Isles have just 15 goals in their last 9 games. They're also just 1-for-22 on the power play in that stretch. They're shooting 6% as a team. So no one's doing well in Long Island right now. I think I've mentioned already a couple times on the show, but the Isles watchers that I follow on Twitter are remarking on how dispirited and discombobulated the team looks in front of Sorokin each night. Like, if it weren't for him, the Isles would be in a bigger world of hurt than they are now. Of course, that's altogether not just offensively. So I think there is some like current confusion and dysfunction for the Islanders that they're working through, but it shouldn't be this bad. And I assume Barzal is going to be okay again when the Isles get off the schneid. Like, the offense, honestly, overall, it seems to be about as strong in the last month during this drought as it has been all year. And we've been saying that the offense, while Barzal's on the ice, has been like pretty nice. It's been good. That's why he's been such a great fantasy asset and why I suggested, yeah, you take that trade, Barzal, for Zegras. So I'm not getting too concerned if this dry run lasts for another week or two. I'd be both surprised and then extremely concerned. But for now, it has been a long time, right? 15 goals in 9 games as a team, not great. But I still think that things will just sort of regress and come back to normal. If you are looking for an Islanders defenseman, by the way, can I suggest Scott Mayfield in a league where a nice peripherals floor helps you? He's got 8 shots in his last 3 games. He's not going to get you points, just 12 points in 48 games so far this year. But he plays like top 4 pairing minutes, occasionally top pairing minutes. He hits, he blocks, he shoots. It's not a bad choice if you're looking for somebody who, like, you know you're not going to get points. The D pool is deep enough that points are out of the question, but you just want somebody to help you fill a few cats in a week. I would prefer Scott Mayfield to Ryan Pulock, to Alex Romanov. He seems to be doing well, and he has great hair in his player picture.
Yeah, I guess maybe the next Jake Walman. Like, if someone shoots a lot, eventually sometimes pucks go in the net, right? When you take a shot, that's what Wayne Gretzky said.
Yeah, well, he is, it's something. Mayfield shoots 6.6% this year, and he only has 76 shots over 48 games. He really wasn't shooting a lot through the front end of the season, but he seems to be shooting a little bit more. Like, it sort of comes and goes in spurts, but it's right now it's coming.
All right, so let's switch over to a team that is in hot mode territory over on Winnipeg, Brian. You're loving this. They've swapped up the lines. So Ehlers and Perfetti swapped. So now Ehlers is playing with Wheeler and Shifley, which is great news for Wheeler and Shifley because Nick Ehlers is really amazing. He's having an insane season. Obviously, he hasn't played too many games yet, but I'm seeing now it's 3-2 for Winnipeg over Philly with a period to go on Sunday. Ehlers has an assist on a goal from Mark Shifley, and the other assist went to Blake Wheeler. So Wheeler was a little bit cold after coming back from his injury, but I think getting Ehlers on his line is going to help him out. So that's great news for him. Shifley had a really good game in the last game versus Ottawa. And you know what? I'm not even worried about Kyle Connor. He's on the other line now. He loses Nick Ehlers. He gets Cole Perfetti, which maybe doesn't sound amazing, but you know, Kyle Connor has a goal today, assisted by Perfetti, which actually I'm very happy about because in our Discord, we have our Tim Hortons, Timmy, what is it called? Whatever. The thing where you try to predict who's going to score goals. And then one of the patron in our Tim's Club, let me just get the name. Oh yeah, the Stripeless Zebra here, Super Dave. He had 6 days in a row of goals. If you get 7 days in a row, you get a week of free coffee. Okay. And then he was like, I'm thinking of going with Jack Hughes today. And then I suggested, I think I would go with Kyle Connor because they're playing against, you know, Philly's not even playing Carter Hart today. They're playing Felix Sandstrom. So I said, I'll go Connor. And then, like, you know, he was like, okay, I agree with you. He went Connor. And then, like, a minute into the Devils game this afternoon, Jack Hughes scored. And I was all nervous, like, oh no, what have I done? I cost the Stripeless Zebra a whole week of free coffee. But thankfully, Kyle Connor did score a goal. So all is well that ends well in Timmy's land and on the Jets. And I don't even know, like, is there even a takeaway here? Like, should we now maybe expect something to change for Cole Perfetti as the one guy in the top 6 who's been kind of cold and is still available in a lot of leagues? Or do you think it's like a shakeup that won't have too many fantasy implications?
I'm going to go with the latter. You know, we've seen Cole Perfetti get into some pretty great deployment situations already this season, and he seems to be able to make it work for a game or two or maybe three, and then not much longer after that. I don't know, you know, like maybe with, like, Pierre-Luc Dubois is amazing, by the way. I think we've already gone on and said this enough. So Dubois and Connor are, you know, it doesn't get much better than having Dubois and Connor as your line mates. And Perfetti has played a lot of time with Dubois this season, but this is the first time that he's playing with Kyle Connor. So maybe that's your reason to give this a fresh set of eyes on Cole Perfetti this time around and think, oh, maybe he will keep it up. And we'll watch to see if that happens. But I'm not thinking, like, my hunch is that this does not make Cole Perfetti a whole entirely new entity than he has been all season, playing largely with playing essentially with Wheeler and then with Scheifele or Dubois.
Okay, by the way, speaking of Dubois, I know we say he's awesome, so I'll just throw it out there for you to swat away. So far, no points today versus Philly. If that continues, that'll be four straight games without a point for Pierre-Luc Dubois. I know he's taking shots. I'm sure you're going to say not to worry about it.
Yeah, I'm going to swat that away. I watched Pierre-Luc Dubois play against Ottawa. He had a couple really good sequences, and like where he looked completely in control. We just talked up Dubois recently, as we have been really for the last year or so. Dubois for real, he's good. If he goes a few games without a point, that just tells me he's going to get one real soon. Like any high-end centerman having a little cold stretch, I don't freak out. And that's basically the status that Pierre-Luc Dubois has attained over his play in Winnipeg.
Yeah, hopefully we didn't jinx him. So you said any high-end center that goes on a cold stretch, you don't freak out. But a winger like David Pastrnak, who doesn't shoot for a couple games, a whole other story. I kid.
I'm just, it's, oh my gosh. I'm trying
to be funny. I don't know.
So funny.
Is it good to be funny on this show? People don't even want Hugh. They don't, go listen to some comedy podcast, right? But they're probably telling me, Elon, just stick with giving us some fantasy advice. So fine. Well, all right. I got one more line combination. This was a recommendation from a patron, Steven, who wanted us to talk about Cody Glass on the top line in Nashville. I did not know that Cody Glass was on the top line in Nashville, but yeah, looking at the last game versus LA, where they chased away Phoenix Copley after three shots, Cody Glass was playing with Philip Forsberg and Matt Duchene. So that's really amazing. And he had two assists. Okay, this is a good recommendation, Steven. So this is another guy. Like we've had Parsonen, we've had Novak, and now we've got Cody Glass, probably the highest pedigree guy of all of them, right? Even though he seems like the biggest nobody at this point. He was 6th overall pick way back in 2017 by the Vegas Golden Knights. And now here he is finally. Is this like one of his first ever opportunities getting like really good deployment like this? And hey, two assists. A watch list, right? I don't know. It's hard for now to recommend whether this is going to hold. And we've seen lots of guys go through this spot in the roster, but interesting for sure.
Yeah, no, this is definitely watch list material, if not rosterable. Like if you were looking, so Nashville, the thing about Nashville is they don't have a great schedule coming up. If I'm remembering right, they only play twice this upcoming week. And then after that, they have another like very bad scheduling situation. So, but they do have a great playoff schedule, but I don't think you're going to hold Cody Glass all the way to your playoffs. So that's why I would watch list Cody Glass. I wouldn't necessarily jump to roster him, which I did, by the way, know. You might have not known, Elon, but I did because I have Juuso Parsonen, who is now down on the fourth line, and Cody Glass is basically on the top line doing what Parsonen was doing, which is putting up points without taking too many shots. On the top power play, it's also worth mentioning that in the last game, Nashville only had a minute of power play time, but Parsonen was not to be found amongst that top unit. It was Forsberg, Duchene, Ryan Johansson, and Mikael Granlund, of course, with Roman Josi quarterbacking. So yeah, neat little spot for Cody Glass to find himself. Like Elon, we've asked about Mikey Acemont over in San Jose being the third piece with Hurdle and Meyer there. Cody Glass is someone I would be more interested in than Mikey Acemont. I'd definitely put him on my watch list. And if I need a game and Cody Glass is available, as long as he's on that top line and he keeps producing while he's there, I will consider him.
Yeah, so something to watch out for, and we'll see. All right, so Brian, we've still got a bunch of hot and cold streaks I wanted to get to end the show. So we're going to get into all of that in overtime, okay? So we'll take a quick break. We're done the third, but I guess it's a tie game, so we're going to keep playing. It's going to be like a playoffs, right? It's going to be a real overtime, 20 minutes, unless someone scores. I don't even know what that means. What's the metaphor there? I guess like if one of us has to go, it's like a goal just got scored.
Sudden death.
We have to end early. Yeah.
If one of us dies suddenly.
Oh, damn. Okay, well, hopefully that won't happen. We'll be back in just a sec. You're listening to Keeping Carlson. All right, Brian, we are back for overtime, hot streaks, and cold streaks. Here we go. I already brought it up before, but let's dive in a little bit. Trevor Zegras over on Anaheim, totally crushing it. He is doing so, so well. Like I said, 9 points in his last five games. Every time Anaheim plays lately, you're seeing points from Trevor Zegras and also points from some other guys, right? Like, he's been playing on a line with Ryan Strome and Max Comtois. Ryan Strome is someone who used to be rostered in most of my leagues for the past few years when he was on the Rangers. He wasn't doing too much this season, but all of a sudden, Ryan Strome has 4 points in four games, all assists. I'd imagine assists. I should have looked this up, but probably assists on goals by Trevor Zegras, if I were to guess. Adam Henrique is also doing well. So has something changed in Anaheim? Is this now a team that scores a lot? Is it because of Trevor Zegras? Like, what do you think is going to happen now in the second half of the year? Are we going to get more of this, or do you think Zegras is on a hot streak that won't be able to sustain on this team that generally doesn't score too many goals?
Yeah, it's going to be really hard to keep scoring on Anaheim. It's really great that Zegras is doing so well, except for you, because you traded him for Barzal. But Zegras is absolutely on a tear. 7 goals in 8 games. Scored those 7 goals on 19 shots, so he's shooting 37%. One of those has come on the power play for Zegras, so this is all to say he's doing well. But I'm not feeling like this is all of a sudden a big turnaround for Zegras or anybody else in Anaheim. Like, Henrique and Strome are also doing really great for the Ducks. Henrique, he's also scoring on a very high percentage of his shots, 4 goals on his last 7 shots. And Ryan Strome is there picking up assists for both of those guys. So good for Henrique, Strome, and Zegras for getting hot. That's fantastic. The team is shooting better in Anaheim, but they're not looking substantially more dangerous that I can see. Like, maybe they're looking a little bit better, but the bar was pretty low. So nothing I'm getting excited about. There's always the possibility that, you know, this has been a sad season for Anaheim. They look dispirited a lot of nights too. So now, you know, you score a few goals, get momentum, start believing in yourself. Imagine this is good and encouraging for the Ducks, and maybe it does kickstart a little bit more production than we've been seeing so far, but I'm not about to jump and think that any of this is going to last for very long. Elon, I have a question about the decor for you in Anaheim. So John Klingberg has gotten in on some of this scoring. He was just dropped in my cupful division, and you heard what my decor looks like. It's not as bad as it sounds, but it's pretty bad. But Klingberg he's got 2 assists, or sorry, a goal and assist in his last 4 games. Not too many shots, you know, a hit and a block every so often. Are you at all interested in John Klingberg?
I mean, his last couple games, he has no points and only 1 shot in each. So yeah, he had 2 games where he got points. He's not on the top power play. Like, anything could happen, but I don't see a reason to jump on him. Probably there's better options out there.
Yeah, I'm not gonna jump on him either. But I am gonna throw out another name here on the Anaheim blue line, you know, if you weren't interested in Jalen Chatfield or Scott Mayfield,
I've got
a guy who you might be legitimately interested in.
Okay, Elon, let me try to guess.
Okay,
so I feel like you're not gonna say like Fowler, even though he's on the top power play, because that's too like obvious, and also he's been so boring. So I guess we're talking about a peripherals. Is Kulikov getting blocks again? Is it Kulikov?
I don't know. He's not the guy.
Who else is there? Nathan Beaulieu?
Beaulieu? No.
So is it Shattenkirk?
No.
Who? Simon Benoit?
Yeah, or I don't know if it's Simone or Simon Benoit, but he's got 2 goals in his last 2 games. I'm not expecting any of that to last.
He hits
last,
a lot,
all right?
I see. Okay.
He hits a ton, and he blocks, and a couple shots on, at least 2 shots on goal per game for the last 4 games. So, like, these goals are sort of what got him on my radar. I was like, this isn't a name I'm used to seeing when I, you know, sort by recent fantasy points. Simone Benoit, he's undrafted. He's 24 years old, but he's got it. Like, he's almost, like, Elon, I've rostered Luke Shen for a bunch of the cupful season because those hits, some games make him worthwhile, and a couple shots on goal and a random point. Random is too often for Benoit. He has just 5 points in 43 games and 3 goals and 2 assists, which is a very strange defenseman stat line. And, you know, up to his 41st game, he had just 3 points. But for a league that counts hits, Simone Benoit could be helpful and fill a little bit of your shots and blocks categories, too.
Sure. Yeah, I didn't think that he would be coming up today. Let me throw in another defenseman who's pretty decent for peripherals, but also I think could get points and is like going to be rostered in a lot of leagues, not just for like that one category. Over in Columbus, Nick Blankenberg, who we've hinted at a couple times. Brian, I'm into Nick Blankenberg. He's been on the second power play, but Adam Boqvist has been on the top power plays. I don't feel like I'm just saying that I think there's a chance that Blankenberg could even get an opportunity at some point. He was injured for a long time, but since he's come back, he had a few pointless games, but in his last couple games, he had a goal against Anaheim with 5 shots, 2 assists in the most recent game for Columbus. By the way, did I mention that Blankenberg is on Columbus? I don't even know if everyone knows this, but yeah, he had 2 assists against the Sharks, no shots in that game, but he's also been getting like not as many hits as Simon Benoit, but you know, 1 or 2 hits a game, a couple blocks a game generally, and just like seems like a guy who's really coming into his own, like someone that maybe we didn't even know if he was going to be a full-time NHLer, but all of a sudden he's like a top pairing, like, well, I don't know, maybe not top pairing, but I don't know, but Columbus doesn't have a lot of great options on D, so they are giving Blankenberg some decent time, and he's kind of hot right now. I know you and I both have him on our couple teams, and I'm not saying I'm going to hold him all season, but I'm pretty into Nick Blankenberg. Curious to get your thoughts on what he's been up to so far.
Yeah, I like Nick Blankenberg. I have him on my Cupful roster, and I'm glad I did. I added him coming out of his injury. And like you said, Elon, he was sort of like a seventh defenseman last year who came in and made an impression, and then in camp made another impression to say, okay, this guy might not even be a bottom pairing guy. Maybe he's in our top four. Maybe he even plays on our top pairing. Elon, if I'm remembering correctly, he was paired with Zach Werenski before Werenski got injured. And I do have a way to look that up. Yeah, Blankenberg was Werenski's most frequent D partner. So, like, Columbus sees some upside in him. And we're not looking for offense for him necessarily. We're happy to see what he's been able to put on the board recently. But, you know, 35, 40 points would be great offensively for Blankenberg. But that's on top of what we expect to be a decent floor of peripherals, couple shots, couple hits, couple blocks a night. And as you mentioned, Elon, Blankenberg still sits behind Adam Boqvist for top power play time. But Adam Boqvist has 1 power play point and about 12 games of opportunity while quarterbacking that top unit. And I wonder if it's just a matter of time that Blankenberg does get a look on that top unit. So I guess Columbus doesn't care that Boqvist isn't pointing, but they probably care that they've only scored 3 times on their last 26 opportunities, which is a 12% conversion rate, which is less successful than you ought to be. So I don't know, something to look into. Nice peripheral floor for Blankenberg, and maybe a little bit of upside, more upside with Werenski in the lineup, though, probably.
Well, yeah, if Werenski was there, it would be a whole different story, and I might be doing a lot better in the Cupful, but here we are talking about Nick Blankenberg, who I have instead. Another guy in Columbus we really need to talk about is Jack Roslovic, and I know this is like something we do 2 or 3 times a year. It's kind of like a tradition on Keeping Carlson. We talk about how, hey, Jack Roslovic is on the top line, but here he is again. He's been playing recently on that line instead of Boone Jenner. It's been Roslovic playing with Laine and Gaudreau. Those are 2 pretty darn good line mates, and he's been on the top power play, at least in the last game, with Jenner, and then Gaudreau and Laine and Adam Boqvist, and Roslovic is on a hot streak. He's got 6 points in his last 5 games. So yeah, you could say, you're probably a listener, you're being like, ugh, stop recommending, like, I'm not gonna add Jack Roslovic, okay? Like, I've done it before, it never like, but at the end of the day, we've got a guy that's on top line, top power play, and he's producing, and he's playing with good players. So what do you want? Like, I had this conversation with John Reed yesterday. Like, he and I had an open spot in our league, Brian, that we're in together. And we were like, okay, who are we going to add? And he suggested, what about Jack Roslovic? And I swatted away, like you swatted away, my concern about Dubois, which I didn't actually have concern about Dubois. Just the concern I rose about Dubois. Anyways, I swatted it away, but then I actually looked at it and I was like, I shouldn't have swatted it away, because why? Like, he's checking all the boxes. So for now, I think we have to recommend Jack Roslovic. Plus, Columbus has a good schedule next week. I mentioned on Matchup Maximizer, they go Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday. So at least get those 3 games. Then you could drop on Saturday if you don't have room for him and if he's cool. But I feel like there's probably not too many better bets in free agency for a lot of people for 3 games by Friday.
Totally. Yeah. And I added Roslovic with my last ad of the week, thinking that I was in the clear with my Cupful matchup, which is getting closer than I anticipated. But I think I'm going to be okay. Don't worry, anyone. But yeah, I've got Roslovic. I was surprised, actually, that nobody else had already snapped him up for next week, as you did in the other league that we're in together. Elon, it's really funny because, like, yeah, Columbus has that great schedule. And you would think that there might be any other decent streaming options. And you probably talked about this on the Matchup Maximizer show. But they're really, it's pretty weak in Columbus. Could I ask you to rank? Like, you've got Marchenko, You've got Bemstrom. You've got Kent Johnson and Gustav Nyquist, I guess would be the other names. Would you take any of these guys or would you just pass?
I mean, Nyquist for a good schedule is decent.
Yeah, he's been shooting a little bit more lately too. I like Nyquist too.
Okay, I would say, well, I already actually did this exercise for Matchup Maximizer yesterday, and I said Roslovic number one, and then Nyquist number two, assuming obviously Boone Jenner is taken. And then after that, I don't know, then it's like a shot in the dark, right? So I think those are the two that I'd be kind of interested
in. Bemstrom, Marchenko, and Kent Johnson, like you don't, like either one, they're all equally unimpressive to you.
No, I wouldn't say unimpressive. Like obviously Kent Johnson is going to be amazing one day. It's just like right now, he's not someone I'm like super excited about for like next week. But yeah, not people I'm like targeting aggressively, I'll say.
Yeah, okay. That makes sense. I'm with you too. Roslovic, Nyquist, and then the other three like could all be great someday, but that day is not today. I guess I'd lean, I don't know. Like neither of them really do anything.
Well, they'll need the opportunity, right?
Like, yeah, there's no one who has a floor. But if you could get like, but it's a little frustrating. You know, you have a team with there's not many teams with a good schedule this week, and one of them has very few options available.
Yeah, well, probably Roslovic is available for a lot of people, so you don't have to look further than that. Cole Sillinger is also going to be really good. One day. Like Columbus actually could be really good soon. It's not going to be this year, but when Werenski's back next year and some of these guys are a year older, I think things could get pretty exciting pretty quickly over there. They'll need some good goaltending, of course. All right, next up, Ryan, let's go to Buffalo quickly, another team with a decent schedule next week. And I wanted to talk about, like, we're not going to talk about Tage Thompson and Jeff Skinner and Alex Tuck. We've done that enough. Let's go all the way down to, I guess, the third line, because I'm going to assume that the Dylan Cousins line is the second line. Though if you look at time on ice in the last game, the line that played the most was Olofsson, Mittelstadt, and Tyson Jost. And Victor Olofsson is going off again, and he's a guy, remember in his rookie year where he was scoring goals like every single game generally on the power play, and he was like one of the hottest pickups. This year he's not even on the top power play for most of the season, and for a lot of the year he had a hot run near the start, then he went super cold, but he's hot again. He's scored goals in five of his last six games, at least one, and he had two in the most recent game versus Anaheim. So you know, you can't get much hotter than that, scoring every game. And it's not like he's doing it on one or two shots, like it's been like four, three shots in the last couple of games. There were a couple of games before that where it was like two shots and he was scoring one goal. So obviously not sustainable to just score every single game. But what's your interest level like in Victor Olofsson? Is he someone you'd be looking to target in a couple if he was available?
No, not really. My interest is pretty low in Olofsson. Like if you got him before this run, which I believe you did, Elon, like good for you. That was great. But I would cut your losses before you hang on too long to Victor Olofsson, who's a Cy Young contender this season in the league. 21 goals and just 6 assists in 45 games. Those 21 goals for Olofsson have come on 103 shots, which means he's scoring on about 20% of the shots he takes, which is about twice as many as we would normally expect based on Olofsson's career history. Sinisity has taken just over, you know, almost 2.5 shots per game, but Olofsson's role has decreased from last year, which had decreased from the year before, which had decreased from the year before when Olofsson put up his one real consistent fantasy relevant season as a sophomore back in 1920. Olofsson had 20 goals and 42 points in 54 games with great power play numbers and opportunity, but Olofsson hasn't been a consistent power play opportunity seer for a couple seasons now. Occasionally he's gotten a turn to rip on power play one, but generally plays as like the ripper trigger man on the second power play. So it's great. Olofsson, like I said, super hot. 8 goals in his last 9 games on 29 shots. That's a 28% shooting percentage. It's nice that like the increase in shooting is good for Olofsson. He's taken 3 shots per game versus largely 2. I know, which has nudged him towards 2.5, which I said a few seconds ago. And this run for Olofsson also includes 4 goals in his last 3 games on 9 shots. So now Olofsson is shooting 18% at 5-on-5 on the season. That's twice his usual number, as I mentioned. And, you know, again, it's nice. Olofsson is shooting more often. Not apparently any more dangerously, though. I think he's just getting more goals in than he should, even with that increase in shooting rate. So good for you, Olofsson, for building on your game, but this is still way too much for us to continue expecting.
Yeah, I had an opening on Tuesday, and Buffalo plays Monday, Tuesday, so I added him to my couple team, but the plan is probably to drop him come Wednesday, but we'll see.
Yeah, if you're a believer in a hot hand, right, you just add him, and you keep him until the goals stop coming.
Yeah, there are not too many teams that play Monday, Tuesday. Florida is one, and Anton Lundell was not available, so I went with Victor Olofsson. Okay, I should mention another guy on Buffalo who's hot and that I think you'll be much higher on, is Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen, who, if he's still available in your league, I think now's... I'm regretting not grabbing him. Well, I did grab him in a couple leagues a couple times, but I kept on dropping him. But even though Buffalo has like three goalies up, it just seems like Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen's getting all the games, and why not? He has four straight quality starts in a row. He's really heating up. And I think we're at a critical moment where he's going to start getting picked up in a lot of leagues, because it seems like Buffalo is ready to just ride this guy as their starter and then play like Anderson or Comrie, whatever, on a back-to-back or whatever. But I think Luukkonen is, or Luukkonen, I should say, he's their guy. And Buffalo is a pretty decent team. They score a lot of goals. So yeah, I think now is the time that people need to be grabbing Luukkonen if he's still out there and you need a goalie.
Definitely. He, as we've mentioned, he has emerged as the goalie in Buffalo. And we saw a really great week from Luukkonen, who was excellent on the penalty kill. Hasn't been awesome at 5-on-5 in his most recent starts. And the last month has actually been a bit of a rough patch for Luukkonen compared to the rest of his season at 5-on-5. But that's because the rest of his season at 5-on-5 has still been really good on the whole. So I'm not going to be discouraged by a couple rough moments for Luukkonen, which, like I said, happily he's made up for while shorthanded, but he is a starter in Buffalo and has a chance to win more often than not. So yeah, he should be rostered in any league, especially if Phoenix Copley's rostered. Elon, not to reopen that can of worms, but if Phoenix Copley is rostered, then Luukkonen should absolutely be too.
Yeah, I think at this point I would take Luukkonen over Copley, I think.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. I think I would also lean Luukkonen. Just with, how's Copley doing tonight?
Still a shutout. Let's see how many saves, though. 12 saves. It's going to end up being like a 15-save shutout over Chicago, I'm pretty sure. Not to jinx it. I don't think that Taylor Radish is breaking the shutout. Just a prediction. Okay, two cold streaks to throw at you, okay? Two defensemen on cold streaks. Mikhail Sergachev on Tampa Bay, who was the talk of the town, stealing top power play from Victor Hedman and doing a great job with it, all of a sudden has gone pointless in his last four games and only two assists in his last, 10 games now. So he's really disappeared. I'm assuming you're going to say he's not really this bad, but I'm just curious to know. Like, he's, by the way, now down to a 60-point pace, and this is falling, right? And last year he had a 40-point pace. I'm just curious to know, like, what do you expect the rest of the season? Do the people who have Sergachev, should they be expecting that he'll go back to being like a super valuable player on their team again?
No. Or
maybe we're looking like a Hampus Lindholm type at this point.
Yeah, I think that's a great way to describe it. Like, Sergachev, the line on him has always been, without top power play deployment, there is a ceiling to what he can do. And that has become even more true as Tampa, you know, has seen their ranks thin a bit, and they try and plug holes with role players because they're kind of full on the cap and the team's getting older and, you know, they've had their cup runs and the window is starting to close. But Sergachev, really cold lately, 4 points in his last 15 games. But to be honest, season long, Sergachev's 5-on-5 production is where it usually is. Sergachev remains a 40-ish point player off the top power play. He always has been. And I believe he will continue to be until he gets a permanent promotion to the top unit.
Yeah, that's fair. Okay, Brian, I got some good news for you. I know I was being annoying before, but I'm going to make it up to you. Dylan DeMello just got an assist. Look at that.
Wow.
What an ad you made on a Carson Kuhlman goal.
Man, Dylan DeMello, one of my worst ads of the season, easily. I liked him because he played four games this week. In the three games combined leading up to tonight, no points, two shots, three hits, and a block three games. Now he has an assist. Well, this is what I was... Oh, yeah, maybe DeMello can get a point once or twice. Good job.
It's
way
like I'm Dumb and Dumber. It's like... what was the line again? When he, like, you know, he sold the truck for the scooter, and then the guy's like, I thought you couldn't get any dumber, and then you go ahead and totally redeem yourself, Dylan DeMello. That was the line. I should rewatch that movie. That was a really fun movie. I can't wait. Brian, we both have daughters. It'll be really fun to show them this movie one day. I can't wait till she's old enough. It's actually annoying that I have to wait so long. How long do you have to wait?
Why wait?
Well, right now Dina says that I'm not even supposed to show her screens at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I can't.
I guess that's a reason to wait.
Yeah.
Well, what if you play just the audio?
Well, she won't get it. Like, she won't get it, you know?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Your three-month-old needs the visuals to really process Dumb and Dumber.
How long do I have to wait? Like, what's the right age to show a kid Dumb and Dumber? I don't want to waste it when she's too young, and then she'll be like, this sucks, you know? And then, like, she'll never want to watch it again.
Yeah, there is some science on this, like screens.
Oh, okay, and, the screens thing. Yeah. But I don't care so much. I care more about just like when's the right
day. There's no science on when Jim Carrey is appropriate for for young children.
So another defenseman that's super cold is Shane Gostisbehere over in Arizona. And hey, the Coyotes are currently up 2-0 on Vegas. I have both Vay Melka and Logan Thompson, who are both playing in my Cupful division. I had to sit one, and I sat Vay Melka because I thought, obviously, but he's the one getting the shutout so far. So lucky me. But, Shane Gostisbehere has an assist. Look at that. That's his first point in like a million games. So is that it? Can we just say cold streak over? He's fine?
I mean... Okay.
He was pointless at 7, I will say, before this assist that he just picked up today.
Yeah, I don't think it's a matter of a Gostisbehere cold streak. I think it's a matter of an Arizona cold streak. Like, they have 2 goals tonight. Is that what you said?
Yeah, so Dylan Genther and then Clayton Keller. And Clayton Keller's goal is noteworthy. Oh, don't you have Clayton Keller?
I do. Oh, he's been doing a whole lot of nothing.
Yeah, well, that's...
Yeah, no, Andrea, I'm safe. I've made it through the week. But, like, Arizona... has 2 goals tonight, which is already a better result than I'm just counting right now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of their last 10 games. 2 goals they didn't even get to in 6 of their last 10 games. This is where the Coyotes' offense is at. They've lost 11 of their last 12, 2 out of 25 power play opportunities. Sorry, they've scored twice on 25 power play opportunities. And the Coyotes have 20 goals on 325 shots, which is a 6% shooting success rate. You know, Elon, we started this. We jinxed it. We were talking about why Gostisbehere had been so successful and why we were seeing so like surprising value from Coyotes. And we talked about how they'd been on a shooting percentage bender for a year and a half. Ever since then, that shooting percentage bender has gone the other direction. So this is a bad offensive team. I don't even expect them to be a whole lot better than they have been over this last stretch. So goals are golden for the Coyotes. And honestly, I've been trying to deal Keller for a couple months now because I'm not feeling great about what he's able to accomplish. I don't think he's bad. And actually, he's been able to still manage a pretty impressive point pace given the situation that Keller's in. Like, he's now, he's got a 66 point pace, which is unreal given how weak offensively the team he plays for is. But I'm not that optimistic about the rest of the season. So I've been trying to deal him, and if Keller or Gostisbehere are able to string another few games together where they are putting up points, I'm going to try and sell my Keller, and you should try and sell your Gostisbehere again, just because I think the Coyotes are going to be prone to a lot of long spells with very little offense, and it's not a discredit to the skill of Keller and Gostisbehere. It's just there's not a whole lot to work with.
Yeah, that's fair. But nice to see he got something today against the Golden Knights, who haven't scored against Arizona, which is surprising, or would be surprising, you'd think, because they have Jack Eichel, who's an amazing superstar, who had such a great start to the year. But all of a sudden, Jack Eichel is my next cold streak I want to bring up, Brian, because all of a sudden he's on a streak of only 1 point in his last 5 games, assuming he doesn't get a point today. I guess there's still a little bit of time. Also, his shooting is down. I know how concerning that is for you. So at this point, how worried should we be that Jack Eichel might, have something wrong with him, or maybe he's like just can't produce without Mark Stone? Like, we got a whole half a season to go. He's fallen now below a point per game. He's now at 34 points in 35 games. Do you think he's going to end above a point per game or below a point per game at this point?
Oh, that's a great question. Like, it should be an easy answer. Like, no, Jack Eichel's going to be fine, but he hasn't looked fine since coming back into the lineup, which is a mix, I think, of him and the team. Let's just go back a bit and see that Jack Eichel, before being injured, 90-point pace, 29 points in 27 games. Eichel had 3 points in the game that he returned from injury. And, like, that was great. Way to go, Jack Eichel. Since then, just 2 points in his last 6 games, 16 shots. But 10 of those 16 shots came in just one single game. So outside of that one game, 6 shots in 5 games for Eichel. He's gone a couple games without any shots at all. And this is compared to before the injury. Like, Eichel, before being injured, his shot rates were higher by, like, a not insignificant amount, like a noticeable amount. He was seeing better on-ice numbers, so his teammates were doing better and his line was doing better. And that actually brings me to my next point on Eichel, which is that, like, his linemates are rotating a lot. Like, early success this season came with Stevenson and Mark Stone. Eichel started the season with Stevenson and Riley Smith, but was not seeing a whole lot of success in those first few games until Mark Stone jumped on the line, which is a big credit to Mark Stone. But now that Stone is out and Eichel's back, Eichel's been playing with like a mix of a whole bunch of guys, like Riley Smith, Marchessault, Cotter, a little bit of Kessel. I think Michael Amadio has been on his line for a bit too. Like, we're seeing a big mishmash. And I just don't know where the merry-go-round stops. And I think once it does is when things maybe get better for Jack Eichel. Vegas as a team looks a little lost, eh? Their power play has also not been great since Eichel's return. Just 1 for 9 in 6 games, which isn't great either. Like, Vegas isn't even drawing penalties at a reasonable rate. So, look, a lot of reasons to not be so thrilled about what we're seeing from Jack Eichel since returning from injury. I hold out hope that he can overcome whatever challenges exist, but holding on to a point per game pace, unless we see him settle in with some line mates that he's clicking with and start shooting again, I would be concerned that Jack Eichel can't get all the way up to that point per game pace.
Yeah, it'll be, yeah, if Stone came back, if like Shea Theodore came back, then we'd be seeing more of like the Golden Knights that we were expecting going into the year. Yeah, it's tough. Like, Eichel's playing today with Stevenson, who's super cold right now, and Michael Amadio. So it's hard to get a point per game with these types of guys, unfortunately. And like on the power play, Eichel, Stevenson, Nick Roy, and Paul Cotter, and Alex Petrangelo. That's a wild
what
top
is
power
that?
Play. That's the yeah. top power play. I guess they're saving Smith, Carlson, Marchessault for the other power play.
I guess so. Shea Theodore, by the way, I think is going to be traveling with the team.
Oh, yeah.
And Petrangelo is still cold. So we'll see what happens when Shea Theodore gets back into the lineup.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, right now everyone's cold. Hopefully it's just good for Petrangelo. I know, like, normally it's like, oh, someone's going to come back and that's going to, like, hurt the person because it's going to take his spot. But at this point, like, they need some offense injected. So maybe it'll be helpful. Who knows?
Well, how about this offensive injection? Phil Kessel on the power play from Marchessault and William Karlsson. So another a Vegas goal that Eichel is not a part of.
Yeah, okay. Good for them. Let's see if they'll be able to come back against the Coyotes here. Half a game to go, 2-1. All right, Brian, let's do one more cold streak. I'm ready to wrap this up, okay? But I wanted to go to the Rangers really quickly. We had a tweet recently from Mojangles, I think it is. People have some fun. Yeah, Mojangles is the person. Anyways, tweeted like a bunch of accounts basically saying, holding on to Joel Eriksson Ek, Trocheck, and Forsling in a Bangers Cat League. I've got 3 centers, so Joel Eriksson Ek ends up getting benched so much that Forsling has twice as many games played as him. I need to drop one, not sure who. And I was thinking, like, you keep benching Joel Eriksson Ek, but like, he's doing really well. He's like having a really solid season. I think he's been really reliable. And I feel like the guy that I would be benching and at this point maybe dropping is Vincent Trocheck. And I want to see what you think about that take, just because Trocheck right now is on another cold streak. And really, he just hasn't seemed to settle in that greatly with the Rangers. Like, especially I saw on one practice, they put Panarin and Zibanejad on the same line. If that sticks, if it's like Zibanejad, Panarin, and Kreider, I think that was like the latest practice lines, that would leave Trocheck with really nobody. And that would be bad because he's already like pointless in his last 3, only 1 assist in his last, what is this now, 8 games. So Trocheck is cold. I'm getting a little worried about his line mates. So I don't know. At the same time, he did have a hot run somewhat recently before this recent cold run. So I just wanted to get your take on Trocheck for the rest of the year. And if you agreed with my reply that I think you should drop Trocheck and not Joel Eriksson Ek, a couple other people said to drop Joel Eriksson Ek. So I was the lone dissenter there.
Yeah, well, let me start with Eriksson Ek, who's having such a great season. He's overperforming a little bit at 5-on-5 because he's involved in 90% of the points that are being scored at even strength. But can you really blame him? Because he's playing most of his minutes with Marcus Foligno and Jordan Greenway. So if he's not producing the offense, nobody else is. So I don't even know whether to count that as like a mark of unsustainability. I think it's just impressive that Ek has been producing somewhat reasonably well at 5-on-5, but on the power play too. Ek has 14 power play points in 45 games, a couple shorties as well. Great season for Eriksson Ek, who's now, you know, settled in on the top power play unit, seeing more time on ice in total. He's producing at 5-on-5 away from everybody relevant. We've got a legit player on our hands here in Eriksson Ek, who also puts up 3 shots per game, hits and blocks pretty decent for a forward, Elon. I can't remember if he was on that list that you were running down earlier. His ADP is definitely going to be higher next year, but I think maybe Eriksson Ek is going to be a sneaky pick for one more season. Like, I was looking at where he was drafted in the Cupful when I was getting ready for the show, and he was drafted 185th overall amongst like guys like Victor Arvidsson and Tanner Janot, Lafreniere. And then actually, it's a really everything's interesting around there. You know, you've also got Konechny and Lekkonen and Verhaeghe and O'Reilly and Shen. Anyway, I don't know that, like, I would definitely draft Eriksson Ek earlier next year than that. And I think there's probably one more season maybe you've got until he's, like, really got that name brand value, which is why I think a lot of people are probably like, oh, you keep Trocheck, not Ek. But Trocheck, such a streaky guy, and just 1 point in his last 9 games. And as you mentioned, Elon, he was hot before that, but cold before that, but hot before that, and so on and so forth, going back basically to the first 5 games of the season, which was Trocheck's first hot streak to be followed by a cold streak. The good news for Trocheck is that he's still shooting, he's still seeing ice. But I'm not surprised to hear that the Rangers are trying to shuffle their lines. Like, Trocheck and Panarin have seen substantial time with 3 different wingers now. Lafreniere, Gaudreau, and Kravtsov. Jimmy Vesey was getting a turn recently also. So I think the Rangers are trying to figure out what's going on. Panarin has been kind of cool lately as well. Trocheck has been a bit snake-bitten, 4% shooting percentage, 6.5% on-ice shooting percentage, and he's really just staying afloat and relevant thanks to power play production, 13 points in 46 games with the man advantage. He's a frustrating guy. I would be curious. I would give some thought to buying low on Trocheck if I was ready to know that this could be an exercise in frustration. And Elon, I'm with you. I would actually prefer Eriksson Ek as the steady guy helping me out on an almost nightly basis.
All right, well, I'm happy that we agree. Hopefully, we'll find out one day from Mojongles what they did and if it worked out. But in the meantime, yeah, definitely not saying to drop Trocheck. But he's been concerning so far. And I'm definitely, like I said, follow gamedaytweets.com or just at gamedaylines on Twitter. And, just make sure you're staying up to date with those Rangers lines. Because, if he's away from Panarin, then those even strength numbers aren't going to improve. He'll still have that power play, like you said.
Yeah, Trocheck has the upside, I think, over Eriksson Ek, but I think I'd rather trade that off, especially if he is finding himself away from Panarin and everybody at even strength.
Mm-hmm. All right, so Andrea asked us to bring up Clayton Keller's cold streak, but now we don't need to because he scored a goal like we discussed. I was going to bring up some Seattle guys. We do this every week, so I'll just mention it. Now, all of a sudden, like Tolvanen and Beniers and Eberle are cold, and Ryan Donato is hot. But Brian, we've discussed Seattle before, and you're saying every week it's a different guy, right? So I would say that probably just hold on to Eberle and Beniers. I've seen Eberle actually drop to like a couple division. I might go for him, especially if he's available. Seattle doesn't play until Wednesday, but if he's still out there come Wednesday, I feel like he'll probably just heat up again. That's what seems to be happening on Seattle. And that, Brian, is my list for the week. Thanks, everyone, for listening. Hope you've enjoyed this mega episode of Keeping Carlson. I guess the game-winning goal has just been scored by Joel Eriksson Ek. So the game is now over. And Brian, we can start wrapping this baby up. So yeah, if you enjoyed the show, we'd love to hear from you. Tweet at us at Keeping Carlson. We'd love a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you could rate podcasts. That would be great. A subscription, multiple subscriptions for the podcast on wherever you listen to, like Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Podcast, wherever, you know what you're doing. We would love if you could just subscribe and get all of our episodes. We've got a lot of good stuff coming. We've got a couple Short Shifts episodes this week, as per usual, with Lewis and Jeremy. Jeremy's really stepped in and done an awesome job in Ben's absence. And I expect that there'll be 2 more awesome shows this week. And then I'll have a matchup maximizer for you next Saturday. So you'll get it all by just subscribing to Keeping Carlson. If you really like the show, you really want to support us, you can consider our Patreon, keepingcarlson.com/patron. We give a ton of perks to thank the people who enjoyed the show. And like Brian said at the start, back at the start of the first period, we have a big patron cast coming up on Wednesday where we do a bonus show just for the patrons where we answer all their questions. And we have a ton of, we have an extra week of questions because Brian lost his voice. Now it's going to be an even longer show. But I guess the upside is February's patron cast is going to be shorter since we'll have a fewer weeks of questions. But yeah, it's going to be a mega episode on Wednesday night. So Brian, hopefully your voice will be 100% for that. And you could become a patron and join us live for that. We have a blast there every single week. We also do our live shows for the patrons. Like this show, we recorded live for the patrons. We had a fun chat room here. So all that and more, check it out, keepingcarlson.com/patron. But with that, Brian, I'm done talking. I want to hold on to my voice for Wednesday. So let's cue the outro music. And why don't you go ahead and read us the credits?
All right. This episode of the Keeping Carlson Fantasy Hockey Podcast was presented by Dobber Hockey and powered by our patrons, including our super supporters, Adam, Aaron, Tyler, Andrea, Tom, Ryan, Derek, David, Rob, Ricard, and of course, Patty. Thank you to Kevin Hebert and our team of co-commissions for keeping the Kakupful running so freaking smoothly. If you want to hear more, learn more about the league, kkupfl.com. That's the Keeping Carlson Ultimate Patron Fantasy League. Thank you, Elon and Chams, for all the amazing streams of fantasy news you are posting over at GameDayTweets.com. You can follow our Short Shifts show at Short Shifts KK. Shout out to Lewis and Jeremy for crushing it there lately. Logo art by BrandonWeave.com. Outro music by Pat Roach. This episode was researched with help from Dauber Hockey, Frozen Tools, Dauber Prospects, Natural Stat Trick, Evolving Hockey, Cap Friendly, The Athletic, HockeyGoalies.org, Hockey Reference, Hockey Biz, Hockey Database, Elite Prospects, and Yahoo.
All right, great job, Brian. I guess I have to talk one more time just to say thanks, everyone, again for listening. And, Brian, looking forward to doing this all again with you next Sunday.
Me too. In the meantime, let's all keep doing what we can to make sure that fantasy hockey is for everyone.